The Venice Simplon Orient Express begins its journey at Victoria Station in the heart of London. These passengers checking in their luggage are about to play their part in a living recreation of the golden age of rail. Perhaps this, more than any other of the world-class train journeys, is a journey not only into the past, but also a journey into the actual history of rail travel. For this train, carries the name of undoubtedly the most famous train in the world. This is a journey of lifelong dreams, maybe to celebrate an anniversary or mark a retirement. Some of these passengers may be honeymooners or lottery winners. Some may be rich or famous. Others may have saved for years to make this journey. But all of them have taken the trip to sample one of the last great traveling experiences. The first part of the journey will be taken aboard the Venice Simplon Orient Express British Pullman. Over a century ago, the originator, George Mortimer Pullman, recognized that his passengers would be accustomed to unrestrained luxury and comfort. He set about creating a train that was to transform travel across the vast American continent. He issued orders to the finest craftsmen of the day to construct, in his words, palaces on wheels. Those instructions were carried out in every respect. In the mid-1870s, the Pullman Palace Car Company commenced operations on a service between London and Brighton. This was followed by extending the service across the Channel. The smart cream and umber Pullman dining carriages of this train are a gleaming example of the innovative American standards. Totally different from anything today's rail traveller would otherwise experience. Each of these carriages are original masterpieces of engineering and craftsmanship, dating back to the 1920s and 1930s, resplendent in rare timber veneers, custom loomed fabrics, and solid brasswork. There are starched white damask tablecloths, fresh flowers, Sheffield silver, and the finest tableware by Wedgwood and Limoges. All of the dining cars have been meticulously restored with affection and care. Each carriage has its own name, its unique personality, and its own colorful history, even its own secrets. In their time, they have witnessed political and financial intrigue, uproarious celebrations, and scandalous liaisons. It's time to board, and time to be transported back into another age. A journey from London to Venice in a magical environment, taken straight from an Agatha Christie novel. A glorious relic from an even more glorious age. The first part of the route will take us from London through the countryside of Kent to the Channel town of Folkestone. The British Pullman has 11 of these parlour cars and two baggage cars. Each carriage carries up to 26 passengers in either coupés, which seat up to four people, or the open areas with tables seating either four or two people. There are 25 staff under the direction of the train manager working on the train. When Pullman cars first went into service with the Pullman Limited Express, they were the first trains to be illuminated by electricity and also the first time in England that meals were served on board a train. Pullmans featured the very latest in 19th century technology and opulence and were far more advanced than anything that existed in Europe. These vintage Pullman cars, which constitute the English section, have been restored by craftsmen centred at Carnforth in Lancashire. The reconstruction of these antique and historical carriages was a major undertaking, involving considerable engineering work and complete interior refurbishing. We are heading out of London, south, over the River Thames, crossing Battersea Bridge. To our left, the four towers of the derelict Battersea Power Station, another Victorian relic. Lunch was being served. Traditional English fare, complemented by fine wines. As with all of the world-class trains, the standard of service was superb and the quality of the food exquisite. As we rolled through the green Kent countryside, known as the Garden of England, the adventure was just beginning. After a few relaxing hours, we were approaching the port of Folkestone. The Sea Cat, which was to take us across the channel, was approaching the dock. We passed through the centre of the town and approach the harbour station across a pier, which stretches out past the array of fishing boats and pleasure launches. The Venice Simplon Orient Express British Pullman pulls onto the station platform. There are not many trains that arrive at a British railway station with such pomp and sense of occasion. To mark the end of the first leg of the journey and the beginning of the next stage, a traditional jazz band was waiting on the platform to herald the arrival of the train. Leaving the British Pullman and the jazz band behind, we start boarding the Sea Cat. The journey across the Channel to the French port of Boulogne will take 45 minutes on this fast, sleek, hover-speed catamaran. Once aboard, the passengers are taken to specially reserved seating in the lounge. Within a few minutes, the Sea Cat is underway, gently slipping away from the quayside. We leave behind the famous White Cliffs as we begin our speedy cruise across the Channel. Less than an hour after leaving Folkestone, we're approaching the Boulogne harbour mouth. Just a short distance away from the quay, we spot the classic Orient Express in its gleaming blue and gold livery, which was first introduced in 1919. Last-minute preparations are going on before the passengers board. There are a host of white-gloved attendants waiting to usher the passengers aboard for the next part of the journey. The original Orient Express carried only 40 passengers. It was the result of a conception by one Georges Nagelmackers of Belgium. Its inaugural run from Paris to Bucharest, made in 1883, made headlines all over the world. This refurbished train, which we are travelling on today, was redesigned by the French designer Gérard Gallet and owes much of its success to the American millionaire James B. Sherwood. Following the original train's demise in 1977, Sherwood bought two of the original wagon-lit sleeping cars at an auction in Monte Carlo. He then spent the next few years tracking down the rest of these historic carriages, along with the British Pullman, and having this section restored in the wagon-lit workshops in Germany and Belgium. On the 25th of May 1982, James B. Sherwood realized his dream as the Venice Simplon Express departed from Victoria Station, bound for Venice. This was the first of the regularly scheduled departures and has run successfully ever since. The next part of our journey will take us south from the French port of Boulogne to our next destination, the capital city of Paris. The 1920s and 1930s were possibly the heyday of this legendary train. The list of passengers reads like a who's who of international royalty and celebrities. Contrary to rumors, however, and despite its spectacular fame, typical passengers at that time were not spies or politicians. There were king's messengers and royal couriers on every run, but their numbers, supplemented by spies and arms merchants, would not have kept the train as profitable as history records it. Britons filled the section which ran from Calais to Paris, and from there, the passengers were mainly French officials and their families, as well as wealthy tourists. Business travellers also abounded in the days before reliable air services were established. Today, this train, just as it did all those years ago, still exceeds all expectations.
The concept of the Orient Express train as such started more than 100 years ago. And the end of the Orient Express, as it was known then, happened in the 70s. Cars were then idle and could be found in various places, in private hands, in museum, and also in some people's garden. Some people, including the King of Morocco, were interested in getting some of those cars for their own interest, and an auction was set in Monte Carlo in 1879. Our company, in the name of Mr. Sherwood, bought some of the car to start a new train. And about 28 cars were bought then, and were completely fully restored. And that's how the Orient Express was then revived and put back to its former glory. When we mean restored, they were really fully restored. It didn't mean taking cars completely apart. Some work had to take place in Germany because the workshop still existed there for some special work in Belgium, in Ostend, for some other type of work. Some work even took place in England, like the restoration of the original panels. Some work, of course, took place in France also. It's a very, very complicated matter to build a carriage like this, but to restore it is, in a way, almost even more complicated. In 82, the train was then restarted, including with all the new crystal, China, and so on. These had all to be, of course, made again. Gently, the upholstery and many of the things you see here, where carpets and so on, were woven again on the original carton, the original design, most of it in Scotland, actually. The original route was for the Simplon Orient Express. Was a shorter route than the one we are taking today. It was Paris to Trieste, then eventually Istanbul for some of the trip, but the shortest and normal route of the last years of the Orient Express was Venice, Milan, Paris, Paris, Milan, Venice. When we restarted the train, we did of course have the link from London to Paris, which existed, but which was originally another train connecting with the Orient Express. So now we've done this whole, the complete service for a number of years, a year and a half, 2 years rather. And then we found that we could use maybe for passengers' interest one of the other routes, which was called the Alberg route. A much longer itinerary, but much more pleasant, of course. After all, although we have the name Orient Express, we're not in a hurry, quite to the contrary. Many people do things where it's even too short. One of the interests of this route also is that a part of the scenery that is in a way more interesting than on the Milan route, we do cross more countries. I mean, we go of course from England to France, France to Switzerland, Austria, Liechtenstein, and of course Italy. That makes it also for European and non-European a very interesting trip. Take people, for example, from Japan, States, can cross then the whole of Europe in less than 48 hours, having seen things which they wouldn't see otherwise. We've added different destination. We often now go to Prague, doing Venice-Vienna, Vienna-Prague, with a stopover in Prague, then Paris, and then London. We also sometimes go to Istanbul, again starting from Paris in this case, not from London, and using one of the very old itinerary via, again, Vienna, Budapest, Bucharest, and then Istanbul. Basically, as a concept, we definitely are trying to provide a service which would be that of a top-class hotel anywhere in the world. There are a few constraints, of course. This is a train still. However, we do tend to overcome as much as we can those constraints in order to provide the best service we can. And we're really proud ourselves in doing so, I mean. I should say elegance will come first, trying to be, say, also to give a feeling reminiscent of the sort of, the 20s. Also, many passengers do play the game and would dress up in the evening too, and that's very pleasant indeed. More than, say, maybe anything, we'd like people to feel they are really sharing in a very unique situation of traveling Europe in this very unique train. There's such a weight in the name of the Orient Express that everyone will find something in it that he wanted to find. It's vast. The fact that it's the only train of this type, the fact that you may be sleeping in the bed that Mata Hari had used also many years ago, the fact that you may be, because you are an important person, you may be expecting and you will find someone just as important as you on board, which you wouldn't have found any other place. Anything can be found on this train, and it is not really our job to tell people what to find. We just set the scene, and everyone plays his own act.
We have arrived in Paris, the train's first destination. When this magnificent train ceased service in 1977, it had become a pale and shabby relic of its former self, and was used as a cheap way across Europe for migrant workers and itinerant backpackers. James Sherwood had quite a different idea. He wanted to make the Orient Express into a travelling experience. Sitting in the bar car as the train glided out of Paris, listening to tinkling of the baby grand piano, it was quite apparent that Mr. Sherwood had succeeded. From Paris, we're travelling eastward overnight through the Champagne and Bourgogne regions into Switzerland, crossing the border at the town of Basel. We're continuing eastward towards Zurich and Austria. The train also on occasions takes another route to Venice by leaving Switzerland into Italy via the Simplon Tunnel, from which the train took its name. The Simplon Tunnel is over 12 miles long and is in fact the longest railway tunnel in the world, which in 1906, when it opened, was heralded as the engineering wonder of the age. As we continue east, stopping briefly at Zurich for fresh supplies, few passengers were stirring. No doubt the previous late-night revels had taken their toll. On this train, breakfast is served in the cabins. Under the loom of snow-tipped mountains, we are soon passing along the shores of Lake Zurich, or Zurichsee, heading for the tiny principality of Liechtenstein, the centre of the famous numbered account industry. Every morning before the passengers rise, one of the attendants' duties is to stoke the small coal-fueled boiler, which heats the water for each carriage. As we leave Lake Zurich behind, the Venice Simplon Orient Express passes through some of the most spectacular scenery in Europe as we wind our way towards the Alps. Climbing through this magnificent mountain range, the passengers are awestruck by the wondrous vista. The final part of the journey through the Arlberg Pass in Austria takes us through the blackness of the Arlberg Tunnel. This is the last section of track before the mountain town of St. Anton, Austria's finest and most fashionable of all its ski resorts. The end of the tunnel delivers us into the wintry sunshine and St. Anton Station, where we stop for just a few minutes. Time enough to get off the train and enjoy a brief moment of clean, fresh mountain air. Back on board and leaving St. Anton, we head east towards the town of Innsbruck, passing through even more spectacular mountain scenery. The whiteness of the snow gives way to the green of the countryside as we gradually make our way down from the mountains. After a journey of less than an hour, we have reached Innsbruck. A new locomotive is being coupled to the rear of the train. Those passengers with cabins at the front will now be at the back. Meanwhile, the locomotive which brought us from St. Anton is being uncoupled. At Innsbruck, the modern Orient Express offers a choice of routes, south to Italy and the end of the line at Venice, or the longer haul through Salzburger Land to Vienna. The whistle blows and we depart once again. The Venice Simplon Orient Express has changed direction and is now heading due south through the Dolomites into Italy. In the words of the owners of this train, the Venice Simplon Orient Express has become the ultimate expression of refinement on wheels, where no arrangement is left to chance and no detail is overlooked. With plush velvet and sumptuous upholstery recalling a vanished era when time was less important than experience, the prevailing ambiance is one of splendor and opulence. The three restaurant cars are famed for seamless service and intimate conversation. The delicious cuisine, prepared by first-class chefs, is the finest on rail anywhere in the world. And the atmosphere? The recipe is simple. Glittering crystal, crisp linen, polished silver, fine porcelain, surrounded with low lighting, reflected in mellow lacquered paneling, and you've conjured the perfect romantic experience. So does this train live up to its glossy brochure image? The best judges of that are the passengers themselves.
We spent the weekend in Paris, and Andrew said to me that we were going to the airport and I presume we'd be flying off somewhere. So I was a bit perplexed when we arrived at the station and I saw the Orient Express, and from that moment on I thought, what a wonderful idea, what a wonderful honeymoon this is going to be. It was a big surprise and a lovely idea, I think, to go by train instead of flying somewhere. I mean, flying is a bit of an ordeal. You get dehydrated, it's lockout, as you sit cramped in a seat for, you know, several hours, and sitting on a train, being able to walk around, having lovely music, lovely food, a lovely environment is such a nice, better way to travel.
Yes, I mean, it's amazing the trouble they went to then to create carriages like this, and the detail and the ornament. It's absolutely amazing, particularly when you compare that sort of thing with the trains or forms of transport you see today. The detail in the cabins and the restaurants everywhere, and the, you know, the polished wood, the brass, everything, it's, you know, it's from another era.
From start to finish, it's been all that I expected it and wanted it to be. It's just a shame that it doesn't last a bit longer, really. But no, it's been lovely and I've thoroughly enjoyed it, and I'd recommend it to anybody.
Crossing the River Bremna, the end of the journey is almost at hand. We leave the Alps and continue south towards the Dolomites and the Adriatic, weaving our way through the mountain valleys towards Trento. It is now mid-afternoon on the second day of the journey. We pass by the romantic Italian town of Verona, Shakespeare's setting for Romeo and Juliet. We are now approaching the end of our journey and our final destination of Venice. Connecting Venice to mainland Italy is the immense Mestre Causeway. We are approaching Santa Lucia station, and the city of Venice is gradually unfurling before us. There is no city in the world like Venice. It is impossible to think of building such a place today. We lack the courage, the confidence, and the creativity to embark on anything so uniquely splendid. And like this journey, the end of the Orient Express too has a triumphant ending. The old tattered and battered Orient Express, which ceased to operate in May 1977, has been given a glorious new life. And this legendary train has once again regained its place in the annals of luxury railway travel throughout the world. If Olga the Beautiful Spy, or some characters from an Agatha Christie mystery, were ever to appear, then this was surely the last chance before this historical train comes to the end of its journey. The name of Miss Christie is now inextricably woven into the history of the Orient Express, but this is in fact almost by accident. Agatha Christie never actually wrote a book called Murder on the Orient Express. That title came later. The book in question was in fact called Murder on the Calais Coach, which admittedly does not sound so intriguing. The title referred to the deluxe wagonlet which ran from Calais to the banks of the Golden Horn at Istanbul. And incidentally, that was a sleeping car train without the day Pullman that was used in the film. To date, the Orient Express has inspired 6 cinema films, 19 books, several television documentaries, and at least one piece of music, a foxtrot called Orient Express, which appeared in 1933. To restore and recreate the Orient Express has taken a lot of time, incredible commitment, and a fortune. In fact, £11 million. When James Sherwood eventually saw his gleaming new carriages restored to their former splendor pulling out of Victoria Station in May 1982, setting out on its journey here, all the way across Europe to the matchless city of Venice, it was the realization of a dream. It's the end of the line for the Venice Simplon Orient Express. The passengers' luggage is swiftly unloaded and taken to a collection point. As the passengers disembark, there is an air of almost sadness, sadness that the journey was over. Train manager and his impeccable staff line up to wish the passengers bon voyage for the rest of their journey. For some, this will be the end. They'll be staying in Venice overnight before flying home the next day. For others, it is perhaps just the start of a honeymoon or special holiday. For all, it has been a journey of a lifetime through time and space. Stepping out of the station, the Grand Canal is full of water taxis, busy loading passengers and ferrying them to their respective hotels. Nothing can compare with the first visions of this city, and the only way to see the sights is to walk or travel by river. The city is full of sumptuous palaces, imposing residences and baroque churches, galleries, museums. There is no other place on earth quite like it. There is no city more alluring for exploring, whether it's wandering around narrow alleyways, discovering magnificent courtyards or Renaissance palazzos. Nowhere is more steeped in history. you can discover the residences of the great composer Mozart, or the summer home of the intrepid explorer Marco Polo. Or maybe you would like to see the house of the infamous lover and romantic Casanova. By ferry boat or river taxi, you can visit many of the small isles dotted around the edge of Venice. This is truly the city for anybody with a passion for art, history, culture, or architecture. Venice is truly the city of romance. No visit to Venice could be complete without visiting the famous landmarks of the city. At the center of this enlightening metropolis is the magnificent Piazza San Marco. At the southeast corner rises the Campanile di San Marco, a 100-meter-high bell tower. The square is paved with slabs of trachyte and marble and lined on three sides by tall arcades housing shops and cafes. On the north and south sides of the square are the procurati, formerly the administrative offices of the procurators, the highest officials of the Republic. The procurati nuovi on the south side were begun in 1584 and used from the time of Napoleon I as a royal palace. The former residence of the procurators now houses the archaeological museum. Along the west end of the square is the Ala Napoleonica, a linking wing added in 1810 on Napoleon's request, which houses the Museo Cora, with an excellent collection illustrating the history and culture of Venice, including paintings by old masters. On the southeast side of St. Mark's Square, extending to the Canale di San Marco, is the Piazzetta di San Marco. Near the water's edge, on the molo, where the gondoliers wait for custom, are two granite columns supporting a figure of St. Theodore, Venice's patron saint, and the winged lion of St. Mark. In the maze of small canals and cobbled streets, you can stumble upon boutiques and shops. Many of these glass creations come from the island of Murano. This is Venice's ancient courthouse. Those who were condemned to jail would be taken across the stone bridge which connects the court to the jailhouse across the canal. As well as visiting Venice's famous sites, nobody who visits this city for the first time could go home without experiencing one of the most famous of all Venice's eternal symbols, a ride in a gondola.
Come on, 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 come on
Having spent a night in Venice, it's time to leave. The Orient Express is sitting on the platform at the station, waiting once again to take on new passengers. The train is being washed, and the staff are busy making sure everything is perfect before making the return journey to London. On board, the chef is busy preparing for lunch. The attendants and waiters are making sure the restaurant cars are ready. In the train's boutique, new stock is being cleaned and polished before it's carefully placed in the glass display cabinets. It's time for a new group of travelers to share the Orient Express experience. An experience that was first shared in 1883 when the very first train built by Georges Nagelmackers left Paris. A means of travel which by 1910, when British high society had discovered the delights of Venice, was the only way to travel, only as in the fashionable way. By World War I, rail travel across Europe had been stopped, yet still the Orient Express made a mark in history. When one of its carriages was used for the German surrender at Compiègne in 1918. That same car was used again in 1940, when France surrendered to Hitler. The Orient Express has been shared by kings and royalty, politicians, the rich, the famous, and those who simply wanted to experience a dream voyage. Now this new group are going to share that same journey. A journey forward through space, and yet traveling back in time in a living recreation of the golden age of rail. A journey aboard, unarguably, the most magnificent train in the world, the Venice Simplon Orient Express.